A title of my message this morning, there's been an exposure. And I suppose that there's a lot of different ways that we can look at this. You know, I know that whenever I was in the oil field, they had OSHA has a, I think it's called an MSDS. It's a material safety data sheet or something like that. And there are all types of various chemical spills that have that in various procedures and techniques that have. So there's an exposure to some type of a chemical. There's a response to it. In medicine, OSHA has guidelines for body fluid exposure. You know, if you get body fluids in your eye or whatever the case, you have to flush copiously with water to get it out of there, and then you have to go through this whole routine where you have to get yourself tested to make sure, you know, that the person didn't have some type. Well, that doesn't have anything to do with what I'm preaching this morning, other than the fact that those are examples of types of exposure. Spiritually, when we speak of exposure, the idea here is that someone's sin could be exposed, yeah. Right? And we know that, you know, nowadays, I actually wrote that in my book. I made that my title, Occult Exposure. I'm going to put it out there. We're going to expose the occult. And so, really, that's kind of like the idea of where I'm going this morning, is the idea of an exposure that's taking place. And in this passage of Scripture, what we're going to see, first off, the first passage we read is that Noah was exposed. All right. Genesis chapter 9, verses 18 through 27. The sons of Noah that went forth of the ark were Shem and Ham and Japheth. And Ham is the father of Canaan. These are the three sons of Noah, and of them was the whole earth overspread. And Noah began to be a husbandman. What does that word mean? That's old King James language for really any person who was of agricultural occupation. If they handled herds, if they handled vineyards, if they handled any type of agricultural work, they were known as a husbandman. And it's the idea of husbandry. That's the work of doing the field or tending the sheep, okay? He planted a vineyard, and he drank of the wine, and he was drunken, and he was uncovered within his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father, and told his two brethren without. And Shem and Japheth took a garment, and laid it upon both their shoulders, and went backward, and covered the nakedness of their father, and their faces were backward. And they saw not their father's nakedness. And Noah awoke from his wine and knew what his younger son had done unto him. And he said, "Cursed be Canaan. A servant of servants shall he be unto his brethren." And he said, "Blessed be the Lord God of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant. God shall enlarge Japheth, and he shall dwell in the tents of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant." And so, real quickly, you know, I'd like to just do a little bit of background, talk to you a little bit about some background information. First off, just off the top, you know, the two sons, it says that really the three sons, that through these three sons, the entirety of the earth was repopulated. That was always God's plan, amen? Just as Noah was planting a crop or making a vineyard, if you will, we've talked about that before, that God has a plan that he's going to produce a harvest from this earth. Doesn't matter for how long it takes him, that's his plan. He planted seed in the ground, hallelujah, and then what I'm talking about is he plans to produce a harvest from this earth. And so, but I want you to notice that one of the names of the sons, these are just concepts that I like to talk about. Now, one of the names of the sons was Shem. Have you ever heard the word anti-Semite? Okay, Semite comes from Shem, the Shemite people, the Semite people. And so it was a collective group of people that were from a broad range as the world was repopulated, but specifically the Semitic people are the people that Abraham came from them also, and so the Israelites are considered the Shemitic or Semitic of the Semitic people, and ultimately their father was Shem, okay? And so when we see Shem in Bible prophecy or in Old Testament literature, he's descriptive of having to do more with the people of God, all right? And here we see that Ham really represents those that are of the cursed lineage. And Canaan represents those, really, it was Canaan the one that was ultimately cursed. If we draw our little map that we typically draw, then what we see is that this is the Sea of Galilee, the Jordan River, the Dead Sea. This little strip of land we already should know by now is known as what? Right here, that's it, and that's ahead of the ball game. But yes, it's Israel. but the name of it was Canaan, right? And so that was the land of Canaan. And so ultimately, the people of Canaan, it was named after him. And he's the one that really saw his father's nakedness. Now, I want to read to you two more passages of scripture, and the next one that we read is going to come from the fall, all right, whenever Adam and Eve were in the garden. This one here came really kind of like right after the flood, correct? And then the last one that we're going to read is going to come out of the time frame of the kings. Now, you know a lot of things have happened in between here and here, right? I like to talk about it, though, so that we're always on the same page because it matters. The history of the people of God matters according to the context, and so we can understand it a little bit better. After the flood, you know, we had the Tower of Babel, right, where God dispersed the languages, or he confused the languages and caused the people to disperse over the entirety of the globe. That's what the Bible teaches, because man was being rebellious against God. God wanted mankind over the whole globe, because in the book of Revelation, it says that he's made us priests and kings from all nations, tribes, and tongues. Amen. So God's plan was that all of humanity would have the opportunity to be saved and to be part of the eternal family of God. And so we have the Tower of Babel, but then we also, after the Tower of Babel, we have in the next chapter, God calls Abraham. And the big thing about Abraham, not to spend too much time on it, is that ultimately it's through Abraham that God created his own nation known as Israel. Amen? And we know the story that in Egypt they swelled to a great nation, right? And then we know the story that God delivered them out of Egyptian bondage through the shedding of blood of a lamb, hallelujah, and that they entered through the Red Sea, very representative of our born-again experience, and then they wandered in a wilderness journey. During that wilderness journey, God gave them some things for them to be able to worship him and to remind them of how they were to have relationship with him and that his presence was going to be with them. One of the big things that he gave them really was the tabernacle. Y'all remember the story of the tabernacle? It was a tent that had the articles or the furnishings in there, which were all types of Jesus. But the big piece of equipment, if you will, or the big piece of furniture, I suppose I should say, is the Ark of the Covenant. It was behind the veil. Right? There was when you first walked up to the tabernacle, there was a brazen altar. That was where the sacrifice of the animal was offered up. See, until you do business with your sin and allow your sin to be judged on the altar, which is a type of Christ on the cross, there's no moving forward with the relationship with God. Then there was the bronze laver, and I've told y'all many times that the inside of that thing was made with what the King James says, the looking glasses of the women. Well, what does that mean? The reflective metal that they would look at their reflection so that they could see what they look like. So what it did was it provided a reflective bottom. When the priest looked into the water to rinse himself, he could see the blood on his face splattered from the animals that had been killed. He saw the blood on his hands and he would see. And so this is representative of the Word of God. When you and I look into the Word of God, we see our own guilt, but we see the plan of God. We see the redemptive work of God. It's written in red. It's written in blood. We're reminded time and again that even though man is found guilty in the eyes of God, God has a plan. He's not leaving us that way. And the Word of God repetitively shows us this to remind us that he's for us. Amen. And he has a plan to reconcile us or to be able to have a relationship with us. Amen. Then when we walk into the tent, I didn't plan on going into this much detail, but it's good. They walk into the holy place, the first place here, and off to the left there was something called the menorah, which was the lampstand. King James calls them candles, but it wasn't really a candle. It was with oil and had like a wick, and the wick had, the priest always had to go in there and do work. The wick had to be trimmed and the oil had to be replaced. And the oil is representative of the Holy Spirit in the scriptures. And the light that was cast from the menorah or the lampstand is representative of Jesus. Amen. The Word of God says Jesus was the light that came in the midst of darkness. And the Word of God also says in Matthew that you and I are the light of the world. Well, how can Jesus be the light and we all? Because he transferred his light into us. Amen. And that now he uses us as a light in the midst of darkness. And so Jesus is the light that provided an ability for the priest to be able to see and to be able to do the work of God that needed to be done. You and I need to be able to see. In the midst of spiritual darkness, you and I need to be able to see. Whenever we're born again, the light of God lives in us. Our eyes are open to the things of God, and now we can see. Amen? In the middle was this thing called the altar of incense. Now, according to the book of Hebrews, this altar of incense was really part of the Holy of Holies. But it was on this side of the veil. So it was considered to be part of the Holy of Holies, but it was on this side of the veil. Upon that altar of incense was burnt incense that went up as a sweet aroma to God. It represents, according to the book of Revelation, not just the prayers of the saints, but intercession. You know what an intercessor is? An intercessor is a go-between, a mediator. See, I can't get to God. I need somebody to go between me and God. God's holy. I'm unholy. I need somebody to intercede for me. The incense was a type of that. Jesus is my intercessor. He's my mediator. He's my go-between. Then there was off to the right the table of showbread. 12 loaves of bread that represented the 12 tribes of Israel that had to be changed out every day. And on the Sabbath day, the day of rest, Jesus is your rest, by the way. You need to understand that. You need to come to church on Sunday. Amen. But coming to church isn't your rest. Jesus is your rest. Amen. And you want to learn about Jesus? You need to come to church a little bit more. We'll all learn about Jesus together. Amen. But what the cool thing was that on that day when they switched out the bread on the Sabbath day, they would actually eat the bread inside the place, and it represented them eating in communion with the presence of God together as they all ate together in communion. Common union. We have you know what a union is? I mean, in the oil field, it's whenever you connect two pieces of pipe, there's a union, there's a connection. We have a connection to God, and our common connection or common union is Jesus, hallelujah, and what he did for us at the cross. You aren't getting connected to the Father unless you go through Calvary, what he did, and it makes us all part of the body of Christ. So when we come together and we celebrate communion, we're celebrating the work of the Lord and our faith in that and how he connected us back into the presence of God. Then finally, one time a year, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest alone, nobody else was allowed to go in there, would be able to go through the veil. Now, let me tell you, ancient Jewish tradition said that the veil wasn't split. You understand that? It wasn't two pieces of material. I'm just telling you what the Word of God. You will not find anywhere in the Word of God where there were two pieces of material that came together like a normal curtain. As a matter of fact, according to Matthew chapter 27, when Jesus died and the earth began to quake and Jesus said that it is finished and he gave up the Holy Spirit, the Bible says the earth quaked and that the veil of the temple was rent from top to the bottom. They said that thing was thicker than a man's hand, and it was of embroidered material, and that two yoke of oxen, according to Josephus the historian, could not have pulled that veil apart, yet it ripped from the top to the bottom, signifying that entrance into the presence of God had now been made available for all. Yeah. Hallelujah. So what Jewish tradition said was that once a year, the high priest somehow was translated through that thing. I don't understand how it did it, but guess what? Jesus walked through walls. Amen. In his glorified body. And whenever he would go in there now, he would have to, and we're going to read a little bit about this morning, because I got a point to make. He would have to offer up blood for his own sin first, because see, the high priest was a sinful man too. He was a type of Christ, but he wasn't Jesus.
Amen.
There was only one that was without sin. He had to offer up blood for his own sin first. Then he would walk through there, and he had to bring with him almost like a portable version of the altar of incense. It was called a censer. You ever been into a Catholic funeral before or something like that? And they have those censer thing, and they throw some incense in there, and they start waving that thing around. That's what it was. It was like a portable altar of incense. And he would have to carry that thing in there. And what it did was the incense provided an intercession between him and the presence of God. Because you remember what God said, build me a sanctuary, Exodus 25:8, so that my presence might dwell with my people. And he said he would dwell with them between the cherubim, those two angels that were on top of the mercy seat. And then so the high priest would enter in one time a year on the Day of Atonement. And he would sprinkle blood before the mercy seat and then on top of the mercy seat. Those two angels, I wanted to have a picture for you this morning and I didn't get it. But those two angels, you probably got some pictures in the back of your Bible maybe, their wings were facing one another. they were facing one another, but their eyes were slightly tilted down towards the mercy seat.
Yeah.
The mercy seat was the covering on top of the Ark of the Covenant, and it contained therein were the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments were not kept by the children of Israel any more than you can keep them today. You can try all you want to. Yeah. I'm telling you right now, don't look at me through some religious face and try to pretend that you've kept the Ten Commandments, because even if you never killed nobody, even if you never committed adultery, even if you never did this, and this, when you get to the bottom, it says you can't even covet. It means you can't have unholy desires to have something that somebody else has. And the truth of the matter is that all of our hearts, according to Jeremiah, are deceitfully wicked. And we need the Lord's intervention in the midst of our life. And the quicker we realize that, the better off we'll be. So what I wanted you to know is that during that time frame, I kind of went off a little bit, but during that time frame, what ended up happening was, after God delivered them out of the Exodus and they wandered around in that wilderness, God gave them the tabernacle, the sacrificial system, to remind them that He was their people, that He was their, that they were His people, that He was their God. And then He had a relationship with them. Amen. Yes. Then He finally brought them into the promised land. And with time, we know the story of Solomon's sin and the splitting of the kingdom, and how the children of Israel went after false gods and began to play, well, last week we even preached on it, play the harlot with false gods, false religions, the ways of the world around them. And that God became very angry and they ended up in captivity. So the three passages that we're going to read this morning, we just read the one on the flood, and we're going to read one on the fall, and then we're going to read one out of the book of Kings. And there's a common denominator between all three. And remember again that the message that we're preaching this morning is titled "There's Been an Exposure." But at the end of the last passage that we read, there was something that was said that said, "Cursed be Canaan." And Canaan was the fruit or the legacy of Ham. Ham was the brother who saw the nakedness of Noah, but Canaan was his son. See, the scripture says Canaan's the one that's going to be cursed. And in the end of the story, that was what was told to Ham. His fruit, his legacy. That was his legacy of Ham. Not that he became an awesome man of God. Not that we remember Ham as being a great father in the faith. But no, instead, we remember Ham, that his offspring, that the fruit that came from him was cursed forevermore. So bad that the people that would inhabit this land right here, known as Canaan, that God would tell his children of Israel before they went into the promised land, that the land was polluted by the inhabitants of Canaan because of all of the things that they did. And the reality of it is that this world, right? Now, you know, let's not forget where we came from. You know, Paul tells us to remember that such were some of you. We were also of their type before the Lord got a hold of us. So we don't want to be self-righteous. But at the same time, we need to understand this world is polluted. God said about the inhabitants of Canaan that the land is polluted because of the abominations that they do, and that the land is going to reject them, and I'm going to spit them out of the land, and that I'm going to put you in their place. That's what the story of the legacy of Canaan is, the curse that came because of what happened between Noah and Ham. Now, I have my own opinions on what really happened on that day. And his opinions based upon the scripture out of the book of Leviticus. I don't want to get into that this morning. If you're ever curious and you want to know, I'll be more than happy to talk to you about it. But this is more of a, from a spiritual sense, that we're talking about the exposure that took place and also the way that it was handled. You see, he was uncovered. And Ham wanted others to know about the nakedness of his father. You see that? Hey, come see what I found up in here. Y'all need to come check this out. Daddy done got drunk and he's all naked, sprawled out up in. Come look at this. But his two brothers chose, instead of exposing his nakedness, to cover. All right. So I want you to hold on to that. Now, let's go to Genesis chapter 3, verse 7. If you got your Bibles, you can turn there. If not, we can get it up on the screen. It's good to still hear pages turn. It's okay if you got electronic devices. I'm not opposed to electronics. I'm just saying, I like to hear pages turn. All right, so it says in Genesis chapter 3, verse 7. Now, this is the story of the garden, right? The fall. You know how the serpent slithered in and gave a lie to Eve, and they ate together. And it says, and the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Now, skip down to verse 10. And he said, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. And then I want you to go to verse 21. Unto Adam also and to his wife did the Lord God make coats of skins and clothe them. So I want you to see that at least three different things happened in this garden experience. First off, because of their sinfulness, they were stricken with fear. Fear struck their heart. And fear drove them to do two different things. Number one, it drove them to their exposure of sin, drove them from their desire to be in the presence of God. Whenever they realized that they were naked and exposed before the holiness of God, their fear drove them. They were hiding, the Bible says, in the trees that were in the midst of the garden. We understand that God, before that time, that they had enjoyed fellowship with the Lord. It seemed that the normal thing was that God would show up and he would walk in the cool of the day and he would have conversation with them. But once the exposure took place, they hid themselves. But not only did they hide themselves amongst the trees, they attempted through the sewing together of fig leaves to cover their nakedness. Now, we've talked about that quite a bit. And in reality, it's representative of the work of the hands. You see, before the fall, Adam and Eve didn't know good or evil. They only knew God. Amen. They only knew God, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil didn't just allow them to be able to see what was wrong, but it also allowed them to see good. In other words, there's good things that I can do. And then we have a hard time many times equating that to being a problem when it comes to approaching God. Why would God be upset with me doing good things? It's not so much that God's upset with you doing good things. God gets upset with people who try to do good things to take the place of the good thing that he said, which was Jesus dying on the cross to provide righteousness for mankind. What Adam and Eve tried to do was to take their work of their own hands and to cover their own sinfulness or their own nakedness. But ultimately, in verse 21, God had to make skins for them to cover up their own nakedness. You understand? And so where do skins come from? They come from an animal. And so what we understand from that passage of scripture is that the first sacrifice was offered in the garden, and that that animal had nothing to do with the sin of Adam and Eve. That animal was an innocent bystander. And yet God to sacrifice that animal and used the shedding of its blood and the giving of its life to provide skins, to provide a covering for Adam and Eve. Now, so their fear of their exposure drove them from their desire for the presence of God. Now, that's a big thing that we got to understand. You know, whenever we have open sin in our life, many times we lose our desire Amen. To be in the presence Amen. Of God. I'm not saying you can't go to a church. We'll get into that in a little bit. You can hide under a false religion. You can hide under fig leaves. Amen. But whenever you get into the true presence of God, something begins to happen. You're either going to repent or you're going to become hard. Yes. You're either going to want to receive the Lord or you're going to be repelled Amen. From the Lord. Yes. Isaiah said in chapter 6, whenever King Uzziah died, he said, I saw the Lord seated upon the throne, the train of his robe filled the temple with glory, and the seraphim began to cry, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And then the Lord took a coal from the altar. And you know, Isaiah said, Woe unto me, for I'm a man of unclean lips, and I live amongst the people of unclean lips. And I don't know about you, but that's what happens to me when I get into the presence of the Lord. I don't get self-righteous and puffed up. I don't start thinking, oh, look at me, Lord. I'm the one that you love has woken up this morning and I'm here. No, when I get into the presence of the Lord, many times the Lord begins to reveal to me my own heart. Amen. I become humbled in his presence. Amen. There's something about the presence of God. It doesn't cause me to be repelled. He draws me in, but at the same time, he corrects me and he brings me to a place where I have a desire to have relationship with him, to make things right with him. Amen. Amen. And so, but the exposure drove them from their desire for the presence of God. But not only that, their fear drove them to remedy their own situation. All right. Now I want you to go to Ezekiel chapter 16. verses 7 through 15. Now, this is during the time frame of the kings. So, spiritually for you and I, the fall regarding humanity represents, for you and I as Christians, hopefully this isn't too deep, I don't think it is, we're all adults, we can think abstract. The fall for humanity represents you and I and our first birth in Adam, right? The fall, and we're part of that fall. The Exodus, as the children of God exited Egypt, represents our salvation experience. It required the shedding of blood of a lamb, and it brought them out of captivity towards freedom. Amen? And so for you and I, the Exodus experience represents our born again walk with God. Now, in the book of Kings, the children of Israel have fallen into failure again against God. So for that to be the case, this represents a time frame in the Christian life when he's not walking with God the way that he's supposed to, whatever it may be. I mean, you fill in your own blank. I got my own blanks to fill in. But nevertheless, it represents a time frame in the walk with God, whether it be because they've embraced false doctrine and embraced a religion instead of a relationship, or whether or not there's gross sin in the midst of their life. In these stories, there's a little bit of both going on. And so what I want you to know is that in this time frame of the kings, for you and I today as Christians, it represents a time frame when things just aren't right with the Lord the way that they're supposed to be. And so he says, he's speaking to his people, amen. He says in Ezekiel 16, 7 through 15, I have caused thee to multiply as the bud of the field, and thou hast increased and waxen great. You are come to excellent ornaments. Your breasts are fashioned and your hair is grown, whereas you were naked and bare. Now when I passed by thee and looked upon thee, behold, thy time was the time of love. I spread my skirt over thee and covered thy nakedness. And there's a lot of imagery here of what's going on. There's a time frame. Really what God's saying is that, you know, you've come to a place of maturity. When I found you, you were naked, you were bare. But you came to a place of maturity, and the skirt thing, we're going to talk about a little bit more, is representative. It has something to do with Jewish idiom or Jewish language for marriage. God married her. He went into covenant with her. He made Israel his bride, okay? And so he goes on to say, into covenant with thee, says the Lord God, and you became mine. Then washed I thee with water. See the idea of cleansing here. God cleanses his people. He makes them clean. Then washed I thee with water. Yea, I thoroughly washed away your blood from you. Now, typically the word, when we hear blood, when it comes to Israel, it's speaking of sacrifice and it's speaking of cleansing. But in this case, it's talking about guilty. They were guilty. They had kind of like had blood on their hands. Then I washed thee with water, yea, thoroughly I washed away your blood from you, and I anointed you with oil. Now, once again, we talked about the fact that oil in the Old Testament and with the lamp had to do with the presence of the Holy Spirit. As the Christian, we know that it required the sacrifice of Jesus to provide cleansing for us that allowed the Holy Spirit to come live on the inside of us. That's the Gospel of John teaches us that. Now, for the children of Israel, we see spiritual imagery here. I made you were naked, you were bare. I clothed you. I went in a covenant with you. I made a covenant with you, an agreement with you. Jesus is the new covenant. He said, this is my body. It will be broken for you. This is the blood of the new covenant. It will be shed for you. He is the offering. He is the sacrifice. He is the agreement that God has made with sinful man. And so we see that he cleanses and he anoints them with oil. He gave you and I the presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen. He says, I clothe thee also with broidered work. It means embroidery or beautiful garments. And I shod thee with badger skin. Shod, another word for being clothed. I girded thee, another word for being clothed, about with fine linen. And I covered you with silk. I decked you also with ornaments. And I put bracelets upon your hands and a chain on your neck. And I put a jewel on your forehead and earrings in your ears. And a beautiful crown upon your head. You were decked with gold and silver. And your raiment was of fine linen and silk and broidered work. You did eat fine flour and honey and oil, and you were exceedingly beautiful, and you did prosper into a kingdom, and your renown or your fame went forth among the heathen for your beauty. I made you so beautiful. I entered into a relationship with you. I took you as my bride. I clothed you. I decked you. I gave you bracelets. I gave you necklaces. You were so beautiful in your adornment as a people. You became a great nation, a great kingdom, and your beauty was like a famous story that went out for all the heathen to know. What's he talking about? For all those other nations that didn't know me. The same thing for you. God will give you a new life in Christ. For those that you love that he hasn't touched yet, hold on to the Lord. Amen. He will give them a new life in Christ. And I'm telling you, when he begins to change things, he will adorn them with beauty. He will take that which used to be ashes and he will turn it into beauty. Amen. And guess what? It's going to spread. The word will begin to spread to all them heathen out there. What are we talking about, preacher? All them people that don't know Jesus. The Word of God says if you're not in covenant with Him, you're heathen. Amen. Matt didn't make that up. The Lord wrote it that way. It's opposite of God, out of relationship with God. But what He does in the Christian life, when you get saved and He marries Himself to you, He will clothe you. He will adorn you. He will make His life in you beautiful. Well, preacher, I've been serving the Lord now for a year, and I don't feel like I'm any prettier now than I was. Guess what? Just hold on to the Lord. I'm not talking about when you look in the mirror. I'm talking about, come on sometimes. You ever look in the mirror and you get past the physical appearance and you start realizing you're still kind of ugly? I don't mean the physical. I'm talking about, because I had a preacher one time talking about people were ugly. I was like, dude, you are the rudest person I've ever seen in my life. I'm about to put you in a headlock. But anyway, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about on the inside. Beauty on the inside. Versus ugly on the inside. I don't know about you, but sometimes I look in the mirror and realize, man, you still ugly. You still got some ugly on the inside of you. You still got some work that needs to be done in you. Amen? Yes. Hold on to the Lord. If we stay in the truth, we stay in the gospel, we learn to submit, He's going to help us. I'm telling you, the beauty's going to start rising up to the top. I'm telling you, don't give up on the Lord, because even if you find yourself responding wrong in situations, your mouth is still too snippety. You can't hold your tongue. You don't have a filter from your head to your lips. Guess what? Hold on. Why do I care, preacher? Why would I care to have a filter from my brain to my lips? Because you're over there with one side of your mouth talking about Jesus, and now the other side of your mouth, you don't care how you talk to people, and you tear them down, you beat them up, and guess what? Now you're and they're like, oh yeah, that's what I need in my life. Mm-hmm. I need their Jesus. And so my point is that when the Lord gets a hold of you, guess what? There's a new husband in your life. There's a new, now I gotta learn how to submit. Now you're preaching some bad stuff to the women in the church. No, I'm preaching some good stuff. There's a form of submission where we all learn to submit to the Lordship of Christ. But at the same time, God has a specific order in mind. And a woman who refuses to see that part and at least learn how to have a submissive spirit. Listen to me. What are you saying, preacher? I'm going off on a rabbit trail right now. Are you saying that every time my husband tells me to do something, that's not what I'm saying at all. If you got a husband that's treating you like a tyrant, then he doesn't know how to submit himself to the Lord. A husband that learns how to live for the Lord should have a heart for God and should have a desire to want to serve his wife, serve his bride, and in return, she should be able to recognize the beauty of that and want to also submit herself to the Lord. We all got submission issues because we all got control issues. Why? Because none of us really want to die. Our old man, our old flesh wants to remain alive, but the cross is an instrument of death. It kills the old man. It resurrects the new man. The new man looks more like Jesus and less like us. Jesus was selfless. Jesus was sacrificial. He laid down his life for his bride. He loved his bride to the point of sacrifice. He did not concern himself for what he had. He was exalted in heaven. He was the word that spoke the worlds into existence. But he humbled himself and became a man. Why? So that he could be obedient to the Father. How? So that he could serve the Father. How? So that he could die for a bride. Hallelujah. So that he could wrap himself, clothe himself in flesh and blood as the human race was, so that he could lay his life down. Amen. And offer life to you and I. Amen. Amen. And so that's the part of submission. That's about the best way, because listen, I've been struggling with that concept for a long time. It's about the best way I know to explain it. Back in the day, you know, well, it just is what it is. If any of my family members ever watched this, then you know what? You knew my daddy better than probably than I did. My mama told me that daddy used to come home from offshore, and he literally, you think, look, people just think, if you get to know me, you're going to think, oh, yeah, the preacher got issues. You'll probably think that. But you just think I got issues. Look, my old man was a trip. He'd come home, he had a white glove. Run that thing up on the refrigerator. What is this? What is this, Elaine? Oh, no. Well, you see, he used to be a Marine. And I don't know what was going on in his head, but that was a time frame whenever men thought a certain way. And many times the women, now we got women's lip, like, oh, no, you didn't. you even think about bringing out that white glove. I'm about to rip that finger and twist it back. But my point is that if we're going to grow in Christ together, hallelujah, there has to be submission on both sides. Amen? Yeah, I mean, you think that Jesus wants to have a relationship with some old cantankerous bride that doesn't ever want to really love him or doesn't ever want to have a relationship with him? No, that's not how. He gave you a free will so that you would love him. Amen? And the same goes with us in our relationship with the Lord. As the man learns how to submit to Jesus, hallelujah, and the woman learns how to submit to Jesus, they really ought to be able to learn how to submit to one another, because we're not always going to agree, but in reality, the Holy Spirit can help us to handle it different too. You know? At some point in time, I don't know why I'm staying here for a while, but at some point in time, we ought to be able to start doing it different.
Yes.
And I mean, we could take it even out of the house and bring it to the workplace. Mm-hmm. I don't know about you, but there's been times in my life when the way I talk to my nurses, I work with all women now. And I just got to be honest with you. I talk to them the way I talked to anybody back in the past. I didn't get a whole lot accomplished. You know? I mean, because I was like, why is this room full? I come back from the oil field where I'm swinging a hammer and sling. We used to sling stuff at each other, throw stuff at each other. Hey, and, you know, call each other names and all this kind of stuff. And you know, I had a supervisor one time that said, if you're not choking, you're not eating fast enough. And, you know, you can talk to a man. Man, look, it works for some guys. I remember one time I was on a job and this old boy was running a pump and he had his old dirty, nasty gloves. And I'm talking about snubbing is nasty work. Y'all don't even know what that is, most of you. Hydraulic oil all over from the head to your toes, and he's over there with a piece of chicken in his hand and that old nasty greasy glove, and he's just working, he's got grease all over his face, and he's just happy because he's been brainwashed into thinking that's okay. No, but the reality of it is that you can't take that mindset and bring that to where I was in the medical field and start hollering at these women the way that I was like, why in that room filled? What are we going to get? You ain't choking. You ain't eating fast enough. And next thing you know, everything just shut down. There wasn't nothing moving. Okay? Because guess what? I learned something. Women know how to, and especially nurses, they know how to make your life miserable. They do it very passive aggressively. It looks like everything's fine. Everybody's smiling. It's all good. No, there's nothing wrong. Well, we are moving. We are producing. And this looks bad. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that I had to learn that not only was it contrary to getting the job done, and I've learned that I got to learn how to lead by example. See, so now whenever it's busy, I don't know why I'm saying all this, but when it's busy, I'll tear the paper off of the table. I'll put the paper back. Because see, they're working. They're so far extended, there's no more I can delegate to them. Now, you understand what I'm getting at? I'll go grab my piece of paper and call the patient out of the back of the room. Why? Because if I don't do it, I'm going to have to stop them from doing something that's more important than that. You understand what I'm saying? So what am I getting at? I'm just getting at the fact that we have to come to the place of service. We have to come to the place of learning how to be submissive. And not only that, I think to some extent, one of the things that I have learned is they still think that, like my head nurse, she says, you know, sometimes I just kind of like would like to punch you in the eye. And so, she says that to me, but she has a big smile on her face. But one of the things of it is that she when I noticed this, she started taking vacation when I take vacation. I'm like, why are you on vacation? She said, because I don't want to work with them whenever you ain't here. And so I understand that even though they say little things about Matt, they like to work with Matt. And I've learned to try to treat them in a way, because not only that, but also I'm over there talking about Jesus. And we all know we got our own personality issues, but we got to be aware of all the little minute details of the way we respond and the things that we do. You don't have to be accountable to anybody if you don't want to. But you need to remember that Jesus is your husband.
That's right.
You need to remember that you represent him.
Amen.
And you need to remember that the way that you act out there in the public, the way that you handle your business, is a direct response to the Lord. Now, what I will say about that is this, because this is, it's almost like the Lord's completely taken over here, is that at the same time as a leader, things have to be done proper and in order. You can take yourself in a situation and become so humble and submissive that people think that they'll start running over you. Now, some of the higher leadership feels that way about me. They almost feel like, you know, they don't respond to you because you're too nice. No, I've learned, too, that I got a boss that's above everybody. His name is Jesus.
Amen.
And I have a certain way that I have to handle my business. And I do believe that there's a way you can lead by example, amen, and that you can get things done. But at the same time, whenever things aren't right, you got to be able to communicate it. And it's the same thing in a relationship.
Amen.
Whenever things aren't right, you have to be able to sit down and you got to be able to communicate it. Mm-hmm. If you've never done that before, then you need to start working on that. You need to learn how to do that. You need to be able to share with somebody how that person makes you feel. How, because if you can't even talk to that with someone that's close to you, then that's a major issue.
Amen.
You understand what I'm saying? And you got to learn how to do it maybe in such a way where you're not purposefully hurting their feelings, where you're not tearing them down right away from the get-go, but that instead you're like, look, I know we've been having some things going on, you know, this, whether this is in a relationship or whether this is on a job. I do this at the job. People sometimes think I'm crazy, but it's like, I got two different ways I can communicate to you. I can either tell you straight up in your face, because I ain't scared to do it, look you in the eyeballs and say, hey, dude, what you're doing is wrong. Hey, girl, you need to tighten up. Or the way I said one time, my nurse didn't talk to me for 2 weeks, the one that wanted to punch me in the eye, when I said, it looks as though to me that nobody around here knows how to even take a stinking blood pressure. Oh, that wasn't the right thing. Not to her. She didn't talk to me for 2 weeks. Yeah, I tried to go tell her I'm sorry. She's like, I ain't ready for no sorry yet. You're going to stew in this for a little while. And so my point is this, is that, you know, there's a way to do it. And so now many times I try to preface things with humility, because I know that anytime I try to bring any kind of level of correction in anybody's life, what's going to happen? Like a wolf, their hair is going to stand up on the back of their head. They're going to be trying to say the easiest and mildest little thing. But boy, nobody likes correction. And so it's kind of like, I'm like, hey, man, look, I don't mean to come across the wrong way. I really want, but I really got to say that. You know, it's like sometimes some people are like, dude, just spit it out. Okay, well, that's good. You can handle it like that. But I just want to make sure that we're on the same page. I'm not trying to frustrate you. I'm not trying to make you mad. But we got something that we need to talk about. And this. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
But it's because you're showing, though, to some extent that you care about them.
Right.
I mean, that you care about their feelings.
Right.
And you care about what's going on. Right? All right. So anyway. Praise God. Here Israel was. God married her. He made her his bride. He decked her. He ordained her. He put ornaments on her. And she had become beautiful. And her beauty had become renowned. And that's where we went off on the rabbit trail. God will begin to change you. He'll change all the little intricate details, even of your personality, the way that you respond to people in public, the way that you treat your spouse. He'll change all of those little things in you. And it's going to come be beautiful to those that knew you best. No, the Lord did something in this person, because they used to be this way and they are not the same way that they used to be. And it's really the fruit of the Spirit being produced in your life. He says, for it was perfect through my comeliness. What was perfect? Her beauty. It was perfect through his comeliness. What does the word comeliness mean? It means to be adorned with honor. God adorned her. Her beauty had become perfect. Why? Because God was the one that was doing it.
Amen. Yes.
Your beauty can become perfect to the heathen out there. Why? If it's God that's the one that's doing it. He says, which I had put on thee, says the Lord, but you did trust in your own beauty. See, here's the problem that we run into. Just as Adam and Eve ran and sowed fig leaves and tried to cover themselves, in a similar fashion, God gave Israel relationship. God gave Israel a form of worship. But what they did was they turned their eyes off of the God who made them beautiful and had relationship with them, and turned their eyes upon their own beauty, their own form of religion. Because I can break this down for you and tell you what it really means, that they, in their self-righteous hearts, just knew that they were the only ones that God wanted to have a relationship with, and everybody else was so poor. And they began to look at their own beauty, their own religion, their own standing with God, and instead of realizing that they had previously been naked. They had previously been naked. They had previously not had relationship with God. They forgot where they had come from. And now they look, oh, I'm special. God made me so. Well, you are special in the eyes of God. We're all special in the eyes of God. He sent Jesus to die for each and every one of us. But her beginning to trust in her own beauty says that she began to play the harlot because of her renown. And poured out her fornications on everyone that passed by. It was his, is what it said. Now, if you go down to verse 39, it says that because of the way they began to behave, God says, "And I will also give you into their hand, and they shall throw down your eminent place, and shall break down your high places." Remember, that's the enemy from the north coming to take them in bondage. "They shall strip you of your clothes, and shall take your fair jewels, and leave you naked and bare." So here she was. She was naked to begin with. She was clothed upon. But now, because of her choice to go after serving some type of a false religion, she's been made naked and bare again. And so there's a repeated theme in the scriptures where nakedness represents the sinful state of man. In the Genesis narrative, we see where the result of Adam and Eve's sin is that they were left naked or uncovered. And it should be noticed that because of their nakedness, at least we talked about it, three things took place. They were uncomfortable. They didn't want to be in the presence of God. They tried to fix their own situation. And again, in the Ezekiel passage, we see God speaking to the prophet about his people. The nation that he created for himself was naked when he found her. Israel is an example of all God's people. Amen. And she was called to him through Abraham. We are called to him through the Holy Spirit. But when he found her, the text says she was naked. We need to remember that everyone is naked before God. In our first birth in Adam, we're born in sin and exposed. But just as the beauty of the Ezekiel passage pointed out, God is looking for a bride that he can cover. That was the imagery that was spoken whenever he said, "I found you and I covered you with my skirt." You may not remember, but when we studied the book of Ruth, what happened in the book of Ruth? There was a story. It's only four chapters long. It's before there was a nation, really. Actually, they were Israel, but it was before the kings. It was during the time frame of the judges. There was a Gentile woman named Ruth. So she wasn't originally the child of God. She represents those of us before our salvation. She came back home to the children with her mother-in-law Naomi because her husband had died. And there was a man named Boaz who was a type of Christ. Whenever Ruth went to Boaz, the Bible says that he covered her with his skirt. What does that mean? The hem of his garment. It's really talking about an outer garment. It's a King James version for saying a garment, and he covered them. And it's symbolic of the fact of a husband that was going to cover a wife. Boaz ends up marrying that Gentile bride, just as Jesus, amen, has come to marry himself a bride. And what I need you to know is that he's wanting to provide a covering. We find the scriptural truth there in that story. But God has, what I want you to know is that God has a plan to remedy our nakedness. Amen. He desires to cover us with his garment and to make us his bride. He desires for us to have a relationship with him, but he can't have a relationship with people that are naked. The state of nakedness is a state of sinfulness, and God is repelled from it. Just as the naked, unless they respond to the call, are repelled in the fear from the fear of the presence of God. Amen. But the covering must be God's covering. In other words, it must be his garment. It must be his plan, and anything else will not work. We saw that in the Genesis passage, Adam and Eve trying to fix it. In the Ezekiel passage, they're over there taking their focus off of God and his plan, and they're putting their focus on their own beauty, their own plan. Well, what are you trying to say? Well, I'm trying to say that religion can begin to give you a false sense of security.
Amen.
Right? Whether it be like I went, sometimes I go to other churches and you see this rote movement of religious tradition. Kneel, stand, sit, move your hand a certain way. I went recently, I saw at a mournful type situation, people had their head covered with, you know, they put like a black thing over their head. Is there anything wrong with wearing a black thing over your head? My point is this. You can sense sometimes. Even sometimes I've seen people when they go to take the Eucharist, they're like so, it's like this religious spirit is driving them and they're so holy when they go to receive this thing. Am I making fun of them? No, I'm not. I'm trying. As a matter of fact, my heart's saddened. I'm trying to tell you that it's a public display. It's a false sense of piety. It's not a true sense of what righteousness really is. And they're blinded by that. And people can be blinded by a sense of religion. And it's not just in those circles. It also takes place Amen. In churches like ours. People think that because they think that their church is something that it's not. You can see on Facebook the way people talk about their church and their pastor. It's a false sense of something that's not right. Jesus is the one that's supposed to be the focal point.
Amen.
He is the righteous one. His righteousness, hallelujah, has been given to us. So in order for sin to be covered, it must follow the pattern that he repeatedly laid out in the scriptures. And one of the beautiful pictures that we see, I already talked to you a little bit about it, out of Leviticus chapter 16, verses 12 through 14, on the Day of Atonement. It says, he shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire from off the altar before the Lord, and his hands full of sweet incense, beaten small, and bring it within the veil. So that's talking about he took that censer with him. Remember, we talked about that. He bring the incense with him. And he shall put the incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony, that he die not. So before the first time he goes in there, he's got to bring some blood for his own sin. And the Bible's saying that he needs to bring a censer that has incense to provide an intercession between him and the presence of God, because if he doesn't, he's going to die, because the holiness of God is contrary to his state of sinfulness. So first he brings blood in there for his own sin, but then it goes on to say, he shall take of the blood of the bullock, sprinkle it with his finger upon the mercy seat eastward, and before the mercy seat shall he sprinkle the blood with his finger seven times. This whole ritual is speaking of the feast that I already discussed with you, known as the Day of Atonement. It was a yearly feast that was celebrated by the children of Israel, and only once a year was the high priest allowed to go in. I kind of did a little bit of a search in my Bible app. 69 times the word atonement is being used. The word atonement literally has to do with the covering. Okay, and the word atonement is used, like I said, 69 times. The Hebrew word is kapar, to cover. That's what the word atonement means, kapar. The word mercy seat is kapara, which means the covering. And so the covering of the mercy seat that was on top of that box, the ark, is a covering. And then on top of that, the atonement, on the Day of Atonement, the blood was to cover that area there, to shield from the sinfulness that showed that Israel had broken the law. Amen. And the blood of the animal provided a covering and clothed Israel from their sin, if you will. And that's what we need to understand. In the Genesis passage, they tried to work with their own hands to cover their own nakedness. Like the sewing together of fig leaves, it is the motive of a heart of empty religion. It attempts to do something outwardly in its own strength to make a good show, but it won't work in the eyes of God because God rejects outward religion. In the Ezekiel passage, it was a little different because they were looking towards their own beauty. They had formed their own tradition, whether it's kneeling or standing, whether it's putting something covering over your head, whether it's doing something that you think your church does right and every other church does wrong other than preaching the gospel, hallelujah, then you formed your own way towards God. You formed your own outward religion, and it will cover you with a false covering of fig leaves, and it will make you feel comfortable with yourself and think that you're okay. But the reality of it is that Israel wasn't okay. She thought she was, but she wasn't okay in the eyes of God. And many times that's what happens when people get caught up in false religion. In order for sin to be covered, it must follow the pattern that he repeatedly shows throughout the entirety of Scripture. Look at Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 through 18. We're talking about there's been an exposure this morning. And I want you to know that even in the New Testament, Jesus talks about this. the nakedness of his people. So not only did Israel, after they knew God, find themselves in a state of nakedness, Jesus says the same thing can happen to us today. It says in Revelation 3, 14 through 18, unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know your works, that you're neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were cold or hot. So then because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew you out of my mouth. Because you say I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and know not that you are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in fire, that you may be rich, and white raiment that you may be clothed, and that the shame of your nakedness does not appear, and anoint your eyes with eye salve that you may see. In the New Testament, the Lord tells the church that she thinks she's okay, but in reality she's naked. The word white describes holy and righteousness. The word raiment describes clothing and covering. So what I was preaching to you this morning is there's been an exposure. And point number one really was, we need some clothes. Amen. And in all these passages, the common denominator is that the people of God have sinned and that their sin has left them naked. They have no covering and that they're exposed. Amen. We are told we need to be covered. But in the day where there's so many misinterpretations of scripture that have taken place, what does this even mean, a covering? You may not have this issue, but since we started the church, many times people are like, well, who's your covering? Mm-hmm. You don't have a covering? Jesus is my covering. Amen. Amen. Are there other men of God that I connect myself with? Absolutely. But you think that just because you got some man or some denomination that says that you're your covering, that that automatically makes any man accountable to God? No. The reality of it is that there's men are going to fall whether they have a supposed covering or not. The reality of it is that we need Jesus to be our covering. We need to learn how to be accountable to Him. Amen. So that the Holy Spirit would deal with our hearts. And so that's not the covering that God's talking about. He's provided a spiritual covering of righteousness for sinful man. Amen. We get a little bit of a glimpse of that covering if you go to Revelation 19:13. It says he was clothed with a vesture. That's another word for garment. Dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. See, Jesus is clothed. And he's clothed in a garment that's full of blood. The blood that's on this garment is representative of the blood that he shed. It's representative of the sacrifice that he offered. His garment is dipped in blood like the skins that were provided for Adam and Eve. The covering of God required a sacrifice, and Jesus' sacrifice is the plan of God to cover our sinfulness. But how is it that God allows the death of Jesus to provide a covering for our nakedness? Go to Galatians chapter 3, verse 27. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ Jesus have put on Christ. You see that passage? Did we get to Galatians 3:27? Not yet? What's that? He was clothed with a vesture. Another word. I'm sorry. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ Jesus have put on Christ. There's another translation that says it like this. You have clothed yourself with Christ Jesus. And so what I need you to know is this. Is baptism how you're saved? Anybody want to help me out with that? Baptism. Is that how you're saved, through baptism?
No.
Okay. But the reason I ask that is because I heard in that doctrine where I was yesterday, such and such was saved through the baptismal waters as an infant. Mm. They said that at my daddy's funeral. No, time out. No, you weren't. Sprinkling of water doesn't save you.
Amen.
No, sir. You have to be of a cognitive age, an age where you can understand what the plan of God is, and then you put your faith in Christ. Baptism is an outward expression of the inner work that took place through faith in Christ and what he did for us at the cross. That's why we always draw the little picture of the man who was born of Adam, who's born dead in sin, right? And that through faith in Jesus Christ and Him crucified, it requires faith, something happens. He's spiritually baptized or immersed. That's what the word baptized means. It means to be immersed or to be placed. Just as the person is placed in the water, spiritually, when you first get saved, you've been saved, I hope. In other words, all you really need to do is cry out on the name of Jesus. You don't need me for that. I mean, if you want me to pray with you, I'll be happy to pray with you. You just need Jesus. Amen. And you need to say, Lord, I need you to come into my heart. And I need you to forgive me of my sin. And I want to have a relationship with you. Amen. And so whenever that happens, spiritually, you've been baptized into Jesus. And the Bible teaches us that we were also baptized into his death and his burial, and that now we've been resurrected with him. So right now, today, you're walking around in a resurrected form. You've been resurrected in Christ. Amen. Now, I wanted you to see Romans chapter 8, verse 1. Romans 8, verse 1 says, there is therefore... I'm going too fast for y'all, huh? I'm sorry. Romans 8, verse 1. Some of y'all are fast. It's okay. It's on the screen now. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. The part that I want you to see is right here. In Christ Jesus. Prepositional phrase. Used, I've heard 160 times in the Bible, in the New Testament. I've never counted. I started to count one time, and I got tired. Okay? But what I will tell you is this. In Christ, just as the Galatian passage is descriptive of, we're in a new place. We're in Him. We've been clothed with Him. In the mind of God, the old man born naked of Adam has now, through faith in Christ and His death on the cross, become one with Jesus in His death and His burial, and one with Jesus in His resurrection from the dead. Through that, you now have been clothed upon with the righteousness of Jesus, and now your nakedness, your sinfulness is covered in the eyes of God. He no longer sees you when He looks at you. That's good news. Yeah, he no longer sees you when He looks at you. Instead, He sees the righteousness of Jesus. Yeah. He sees the beauty of the obedient one. Hallelujah. This is the plan of God. We see the thematic recurrence through the scripture of God's people being naked, but then at the same time being clothed upon. And ultimately what we need to know is this. Jesus said to the church of Laodicea in the book of Revelation, you think that you're rich and increased, but you're blind, you're naked, and you're poor. I'm counseling you to buy of me gold that's been refined in fire, and so that you might be clothed upon with white raiment. What Jesus is offering is righteousness. Hallelujah. He's offering to give His righteousness. Righteousness as a gift, Romans chapter 5, verse 17, to us so that we can be clothed with it, so that we can be now righteous in the eyes of God. There's been an exposure. Point number one, we need some clothes, and the clothes that we need is the righteousness of Jesus given to us as a gift as He shed His blood and He purchased righteousness for us. Amen. Now, point number two, and this won't take long, goodwill. You know, I was thinking the other day whenever Danielle told me that Isabella found a shirt from the loft at Goodwill for $3. And at first I was like, man, I mean, I don't know what the loft is, but I heard it. I guess it's a nice place. I mean, I asked Bella the other day, how much you think that shirt would have cost you at the loft? Probably about $35. I'm like, okay, that's a good deal. Goodwill. People got, hey, whoever this old girl was, she didn't need that shirt anymore. She probably got a closet full of new ones from the loft. And she had some goodwill in her heart for fellow human beings. She brought that stuff to the Goodwill, and the Goodwill made $3 off of us. Yeah, I started thinking about that Goodwill, though, but then it made me think about this message. And it made me think about the fact that there's been an exposure. It made me think about the fact of the clothing, that we need to be clothed with the righteousness of God. But it also made me think about the goodwill that God has given to us in the giving of His Son. Amen?
Amen.
But it also made me think about this story of Noah, where we started. And where we started was that Ham saw the nakedness of his father. You know, the truth of the matter is that God's been so good to us. He's shown so much goodwill to us.
Amen.
many of you know in here right now that there's been a whole lot of things that have taken place in your life that maybe some of that stuff's been exposed, but you're probably glad that it hadn't all been exposed.
Amen.
Maybe not. Maybe you ain't like me. Maybe you didn't do stuff as bad as me. But I sure am grateful that not everything has been exposed.
Amen.
Right? But the reality, and God has gone through a great work to cover our nakedness, to cover our sinfulness. But the reality of it is that many times we're a whole lot more like Ham than we are Jesus. When it comes to the sinfulness of other people, we sure don't mind blasting them, boy. Like, we're going to blast them now. That's what the young kids say nowadays. You just got blasted. I don't even know if they still use that word anymore. It's probably dead now. But it wasn't not that long ago. You're about to get blasted. And they'll just blast you all over. They got social media now, man. You were cool one day, the next day you were the coolest thing that you ever seen. You see? And people are so hungry to expose somebody's failure. I'm telling you right now, that's not of the Lord. I'm telling you right now, the Lord went through all of the work that he went through to cover the nakedness of you and I, to cover our sinfulness, that the reality of it is that we're supposed to operate more like Shem and Japheth than we are like Ham. We're supposed to be walking backwards and covering the nakedness of our brother. We should want to lead them through love to a place of redemption. We should want to lead them to a place where their heart could be restored to the Lord. If we're over here in a back room thinking, I know one day that person right there, they're going to get exposed and it's going to be a fine day. If we're over there thinking that way, there's something wrong internally. And the reason I can say that is because I've thought that way before. Is it okay if I'm just honest with you? I've thought that way before. Oh, they're going to get theirs. Wait, it's going to happen. And guess what? You might get yours too, preacher. And the scripture, I got scripture to back up what I'm talking to you about. All right? I'm not just a story, but a scripture out of Galatians that tells us the way things are supposed to be. But before we get there, let's go to Proverbs chapter 11. We're about to close. Proverbs 11, verses 12 through 13. He that is void of wisdom despises his neighbor, but a man of understanding holds his peace. A talebearer reveals secrets, but he that is of a faithful spirit conceals the matter. Both of these in the book of Proverbs represent somebody who's got a problem with their mouth. The first person, he just can't control his mouth. He gets into a situation, and I know that I've been guilty of that plenty of times. You don't know how to just control your own mouth. No filter between the head and the mouth. And you just rail on somebody, or you just let them know how it is. The point that I'm trying to make is this, is that both cases, they can't control their mouth. In the first case, they rail on somebody, or they treat somebody harshly with their tongue. You ever done that before?
Yeah.
Cut somebody. Yeah. Some people are really good at it, by the way. I've learned that. You know, and I'm pretty sure that I've been pretty good at it myself. You know, I mean, I'm just being honest. I mean, but some people are like experts. Like, they hone that blade, dude. And like, I mean, you know, that tongue just rip you to shreds, man. You just leave out of there bleeding, dude. I need some gauze. I'm bleeding. There's been an exposure already. I got a body fluid exposure going on here. All right. But the second one is you got a problem with your tongue. Just can't help themselves. It's like Proverb also talks about, it's like a juicy morsel. It's a juicy morsel to talk about people's stuff. Oh, it just feels so good. Like, it's a lust of the flesh, man. It's like, it's a talebearer. It's like, oh, man. And I know I've been guilty of this before. I know it's spiritual because I don't know why, but I used to actually talk about other people's business. Why do I care enough to talk about other people's business? Surely I got enough issues of my own to deal with. And you know, I can think to myself, after the Lord got a hold of me, that was one of the first things. I'm not saying I still won't ever do it, you know, but that was one of the first things that the Lord started checking, giving me a gut check about. It's like, why are you talking about people's business? It's like, what are you doing? You know? But y'all know what I'm talking about. Sometimes, dude, it's like, man, it feels so good to talk about people's business. What is that? That's the devil. It sure ain't the Holy Ghost making your flesh feel good talking about people's business like that. Lord, help us. Amen. Change us.
Yes, Lord.
Both of these represent people that have a hard time holding their tongue. So we have a situation where Jesus gave his life so that the nakedness that started all the way back in the garden could be covered. And here we would rather expose the issues of people. The New Testament also has something to say about this. Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. And then we're going to be, I promise we'll be real close to closing. Galatians 6, verse 1. It says, "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted." So the idea here is that you found a brother, he was overtaken in a fault. Some people are a little bit divided whether or not he didn't expect to get caught up in the fault, or he knew he was in the fault and he just didn't have the strength to overcome it for whatever the reason, but he got caught. Alright? And so now there's two ways you can handle the situation. You can either restore him through gentleness and meekness, or you can blast him. You can expose him. Alright? And so the word gentle means, the word meek means gentle and mild. To restore, this word was used in the Greek to talk about mending bones or mending nets that had holes in them. So it's the idea of reparation or repairing something. Jesus was meek and gentle like a lamb when he went to the slaughter for you and I, and now he desires for you and I to do the same thing for others, to put them in an environment where their neck that's ripped can be mended, where their bones that are broken can be healed. Amen? And there's also a warning in this verse. The warning says that if you don't handle your business like this, yourself also may be tempted. And in the Greek language, the idea is that you might be tempted with the same sin that they were tempted. Oh no, preacher, I ain't going to be tempted with that one. You better hold on a second. Because the Lord's the one that's saying that that the temptation will come your way. Now the Lord doesn't tempt with evil. Don't get me wrong, but if he holds back his hand a little bit and holds back grace a little bit, you don't know what's on the inside of your heart. You don't know what you might would be tempted with. And I really want to end this story with the idea of this, that Ham was the one who wanted to expose his father's nakedness. And ultimately, it was the fruit of his legacy that was left, which was Canaan, that was cursed. And the scripture right here is saying that if you and I aren't careful in the way that we handle other people, that we also could end up being tempted too in that same area. And I just know that it's a sad thing when anybody falls. You know what I'm saying? It just really is, because none of us really want to fail God. None of us do. The reality of it is that none of us are perfect in the eyes of God. But except for through Christ. Amen. And the truth is that if we have the heart of the Lord to restore a brother or sister in the ways of God, then God's grace will flow in our life and continue to give us strength. But if we do it the wrong way, our legacy may very well end up being a curse, kind of like it was with Canaan. It doesn't mean that God still can't restore even after a fall like that or after something bad happens, because God is in the restoration business. And many times, people, because they fall, it causes them to be humbled even more and causes God to really get a hold of their hearts. And you know, but I just want to encourage you, because that's something that the Lord put in my heart. We shouldn't, if we think that way about people sometimes, whenever we hear a story about, you know, oh, this one fell, or that happened to that person, or like what happened over here, our hearts should really be broken for them, you know, rather than us like it being like a juicy morsel like I was talking about. I know it's kind of funny, but that's because we can all relate to it. We've all experienced it before.